Welcome. We are so excited to have you. We're so excited to have our panelists here. I think it's going to be a really incredible discussion. First, we want to say thank you so much to SAG-AFTRA for sponsoring this panel. And I'd like to bring up Mary Cavallaro, our Chief Broadcast Officer, who is such a champion of all of the work that we do as journalists. I get to witness it firsthand as a member of the Broadcast Steering Committee. And she's going to just say a quick welcome for us. But welcome to Mary. Thank you.
First of all, thank you so much, all of you, for being here. And SAG-AFTRA is so proud of our partnership that has existed for years with AAJA. And we're so excited to put this panel on today. So please enjoy the conversation. And if you have a moment, if you haven't done it already, please stop by our booth on the floor. Thanks again.
Thank you, Mary. All right, thank you so much. So this panel today is Harnessing Hollywood, Confronting Against Anti-Asian Hate. And what better conversation to start than to introduce these panelists here who do so much for all of us in terms of representation and fighting anti-Asian hate. So we're gonna have a really good conversation. And of course, I wanna make sure that there's enough time for questions at the end so that you get to be a part of the conversation as well. So first, I'm going to start by introducing, just in the order that I've written this here, but Jodie Long in the middle here in the beautiful yellow dress. So she is an actress, writer, producer, and SAG-AFTRA's local president here in Los Angeles. Last year, Jodie won an Emmy for Best Supporting Actress as Mrs. Basil E. in Netflix's Dash and Lily, becoming the very first Asian American to win an Emmy in any acting category. Yes. Woo. Her career has spanned 5 Broadway shows, many television shows, films, and Awkwafina's mom in Shang-Chi and The Legend of the Ten Rings. 6 years ago, along with 25 other Asian American members of the Academy, Jodie met with the Academy leadership over how Asians were being portrayed in the Oscars So White telecast, and that began a sea of change of diversity and inclusion within the Academy. So welcome, Jodie. Thank you. To my left here is anchor reporter from KGO TV and author Dion Lim. So before the Bay Area, Dion was the first and only Asian American full-time anchor at stations in Kansas City, Charlotte, North Carolina, and Tampa Bay. The past few years, she has championed AAPI stories and was named a Gold House A100 recipient, along with Kamala Harris and other notable Asian Americans, for being one of the most influential voices in media. And she most recently was invited by the Biden administration as the only local journalist to take part in the White House's AAPI reception. Yeah. Please welcome actor John Briones. John was born and raised in the Philippines, and he started in theater and has been in several productions, including Miss Saigon, playing the role of the engineer. He can also be seen on TV in Ratchet and the Assassination of Gianni Versace. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for being here. And Jordan Rodriguez, actor and performer Jordan Rodriguez, will next be seen starring in the new Disney Plus series National Treasure, which is set to premiere later this year. He was last seen as one of the leads in the Hulu miniseries Light as a Feather. He was also seen on a large arc in season 1 of the Gabrielle Union and Jessica Alba series LA's Finest, along with a lot of other stuff. Everybody has a very extensive resume, so thank you so much. So the conversation that we're about to have, you know, can be really heavy and tough, but I want to start with how being Asian in your line of work has actually brought you joy and has helped you in your career. So why don't we start with Dion?
It didn't give me joy for a very long time, Veronica. Let me just put this out there right away, because being the first and only Asian American woman in all these places, and this is in the past 17 years, mind you, so really not all that long ago, it came with so many challenges. I'd be out in public and people would go, "Hey, news lady, hey, news lady." And then they would say, "Connie Chung came to Kansas City." And I'm like, really, people? I'm glad you guys know who Connie Chung is, by the way, because certain demographics have no clue. But really, I think it wasn't until the start of the pandemic, and I realized that in addition to just having that seat at the table, I had a platform, and I could use that seat and actually do good with it. So I think the joy for me has been realizing that there are people, like the people I'm sitting next to and in the audience, that have that same shared experience. And when you do, and you can elevate that and bring it to an audience that normally does not have that same lens, I think that's a small win that we can all take from.
Most definitely. Yeah. How about you, John?
I'm the same. In the beginning, the joy is finding what I love to do, which is acting. But when I got to, this is not my, I came from the Philippines, third world country. My first world country that I've been to, it was London. UK, and then America. But there was no understanding of who I am. There was one agent saying, maybe you should change your name because you look Hispanic. Before you enter the room, they read John Briones. They're expecting a Hispanic guy. Maybe change your name. So I resisted it, but at the same time, I was like, I'm going to fail here. And so the joy was disappeared. You know, the joy should always be in your heart, and the joy was not in my heart in the beginning. And then I found community. It was hard because there was nobody, really. I felt like I had to find the community. Once you find it, you get introduced to more people, and the joy kept building up, and we started doing more work and pushing each other, and now we're in this position, in this situation right now that is much better, and I'm grateful for that, and the joy is back.
I love to hear that.
Well, let's see. I played a lot of newscasters in my career. And my father actually told me to go to Emerson College to become a newscaster because, like Connie Chung, I would make a lot of money. And I said, I'm not going to be a newscaster, Dad. I'm an actor. But anyway, I think it's been hard. I mean, you know, in the beginning. And the joy for me has always been, I'm really not a political person, even though I'm the president of the SAG-AFTRA local. But I think it's a political statement every time I show up on the stage, or on film, television. Because if I'm really doing my job as an actor, yes, everyone's going to see an Asian woman when we first get out there, right? If I'm really doing my job, they'll just see a woman, in the end, who is just like them, who is going through this particular set of circumstances, who's a human being. And that's the thing, for me, is the most important thing to elevate and change the narrative. And the more our stories get out there, that people will just see we're just human beings like them. And that's the crossover and the shift in consciousness that brings me joy, personally. Okay, so that's my goal, and it's not just as an actor, it's as a writer, it's as a producer, it's as a contributor to the community, whether it's the Television Academy or the Motion Picture Academy. Unconscious bias, you know, I help bring unconscious bias to the DGA at the Produce By, because people need to understand where their bias lies, whether it's an Asian person or a Hispanic person or a black person, and that we're all in this together. Anyway.
Definitely. Thank you.
How do you follow that up? I mean, my perspective is, when I was getting into film and TV, I just wanted to act. I didn't see myself as different in the community growing up in Australia. But when I was on TV, when I first got a gig on Home and Away and then Dance Academy later, the response was actually quite overwhelming from the tweets and the people that would meet me on the street and say that we haven't seen someone like you on TV. And it's really changed their way of seeing Asian people, but also kids that want to be actors and want to go after it because now they are represented. Now they see that it can be done. And I think those moments with those people was the first bit of joy that I found outside of acting. Now that I'm in America, there's a real opportunity for us to represent more of us, more different characters, and really be heard louder. And I'm finding every day and every year and every character and job that I do, I find new joy. And I hope that just stays for the rest of my career and the rest of my life.
Yeah, most definitely. I think you guys touched on this, and you just said it, the importance of the diversity of characters. I'm curious if there's any other women in the room who've experienced this, but how many times I've been called Trisha Takanawa, the Family Guy newscaster, the one and only newscaster, you know, just kind of like that Connie Chung statement.
Can I just say my now husband, we've been together 16 years, gave me a Trisha Takanawa doll on our first date.
Wow.
And we're still
and
together.
And you're married?
And we're still together. Because people don't understand. It's that ignorance, right? Mm-hmm. And even
it's obviously
if,
not Asian, right?
How did you guess? But I found it so funny, though. I mean, that's part of dealing with it, right? Is understanding that people don't have necessarily the intent of being malicious. It's more so just not understanding because they've never seen it.
Right, yeah. Exactly. Because they've never seen it, and that's why it's so important that we continue to have more diverse roles. You guys kind of touched on this a little bit, but I'd like you to speak on, I guess, some of the more significant moments in your career that have been painful. We talked about joy. Let's go to the other side. Is there a moment that you really had to confront anti-Asian hate or any kind of an implicit bias that you can speak on?
I guess I'm going to start.
If you'd like to start, or feel free, you guys take the lead.
There's a 1 minute, 21 second video that I played at an ABC Storytellers panel. You were there, a couple of familiar faces were there. And it illustrates the pain of what we are all going through right now, even if you are not Asian American, to see something that is so brutal, the verbal, the physical attacks, the personal attacks on Asian Americans during this time, especially when the pandemic broke out, has been so heavy on so many people's hearts. And for me, what I do first thing in the morning, which is not very healthy, but I scroll through my social media and I count how many incidents come to my inbox or to my email, and then having the burden of choosing which one gets to rise to the surface. Today I had one of a woman who had been called a slur on an airline's flight. And I asked her very empathetically, I said, I'm really sorry this happened to you. Can you tell me a little bit more? Is there anything visual that I can use in a story potentially? I want to help you get your voice heard. When she said no, I felt so callous in not being able to report it, because that's going to be the first question, is there a visual that can get people's attention? That doesn't mean your story gets to die in the darkness. It's deciding how am I going to make that into a story that broadens it out, that is compelling and is maybe part of a bigger story that we can share with the audience. So that pain is an everyday pain, but it's just about managing it and through mental health. And I broke down during that 1 minute, 21 second video on TV, and I've done it three times now. Is that three? Yeah, three times. And it's the cardinal sin of being in TV, right? And you're not supposed to show your emotions, but I think we're all human, and I think when you do, people have that way to relate to you, and therefore opens up the entire world.
Yeah, that's right. Getting emotional about, you know, what you're covering. And John, you talked about how you get emotional sometimes, and then that brings out your accent. You've been told to tone that down. Can you explain that to us?
Well, I've lost, I think, a couple of roles because of my accent. I've worked so hard to sound American, but when I get emotional, this is what we do, we get emotional, it comes out. And one time I was asked by a casting person, I like you, I'm gonna bring you back, but you need to lose that accent. And I was like, what accent? I thought, I don't have it. You need to sound American. And I was devastated because what else can I do? That was the best I can do. But once I get emotional, and the scene was so emotional, it comes out. I went back to the callback, and I can see the casting person. When I started, his head was just like this. And I was like, no, I lost because I didn't sound American. And I was like, and now when I think about that, what is an American sound? I've been watching Hollywood, black and white Hollywood films, and there were so many Americans there, a librarian with an Eastern European accent, and nobody, you know, that was not an issue. He's American. But once the people who look like us have an accent, we're foreigners, we're aliens, we don't belong, we're not Americans. And that is why I always say, I was asked this, what do you want to see in Hollywood? I want Hollywood to normalize this accent as an American. I know, and there's another side to that. People, producers asking actors, can you put more accent in that? And that's the other side of it. But I am American. I'm a proud American, and I sound like this. And that hurts, I'm one of my heroes I'm blacking out. Puerto Rican late actor Adam's Family, Raul Julia, and he said, I can play Shakespeare, I can be an American with this accent. And I went, yes, I'm with you. From now on, I will stand my ground. I am American and I sound like this.
Well, I've got a lot of stories, but we don't have the time. There's two things that you talked about. And one is, I'm Chinese, Japanese, Australian, American. And I've been a New Yorker all my life. And after all the Asian hate last spring, right, in San Francisco, in New York City, where this man just beat this woman almost to a pulp in front of a doorman who didn't help her, it was horrifying. And I really felt, for the first time in my life, I'm a New Yorker, I was scared to walk down the street in New York City. I've never been scared because, like, I'm a New Yorker, get out of my way, and I know exactly who's walking behind me. But because it was the pandemic, I knew I had a mask on, I had my fedora on, I had my sunglasses on, and I really considered at one point of putting my hair up so they couldn't see my long hair. And I thought, Jody, there's something wrong with this picture, right? That I would be scared for the first time in my life. So I just want to address that because it was real. And I was asked by, Con Nasser, like, what do you do when you're walking down the street? And I said, well, if I see someone who's a little slightly off, maybe 2 years ago I wouldn't have done this, I just cross the street now. I am not going to be open. Or if I'm on the subway and I see someone slightly strange, I get off the train. And this is a sad state of affairs right now. So I just wanted to say that because you mentioned it. Going back to the accent thing, I've had so many different accent stories. And I remember once auditioning for Stephen Sondheim for his first non-musical play on Broadway. And I went in and I did it just as this woman. She was an American, I thought. She was a teacher in a college. And Steve, in the room, said, can you please do an accent for this? And I said, what kind of accent? It wasn't written that way. And he said, I don't know, any kind of, just do an Asian accent. So I did an Asian accent, a Chinatown accent. And he thought it was so funny. He just laughed at everything I said. Not because the lines were funny, but because the accent was funny. And I got home, and I got a call from the director, Jack O'Brien, Tony Award, many, many Tony Awards. And he said, Jody, you got the job. Great. But Steve really wants you to do this accent. I said, what accent? The Chinatown accent I gave you? It doesn't say she's from Chinatown. And he said, oh, it doesn't matter. Just do that accent you did because it was so funny. And I really had to think about it. And I said, you know, Jack, this woman is an educator in college. And her big thing is she is jealous, because it was about the seven deadly sins. Everybody had a sin, right? It was a comedy. And she's jealous because she's being overlooked for promotion, not just because she's a woman, but because she's an Asian woman. And I'm sorry, if she has an accent, a really thick accent that Steve wanted me to do, she would be an immigrant. And the one thing I think, character-wise, she would just be happy to have the job. It's an Asian American thing to be worried about your status, to be moving up within a predominantly white institution. And this is a long time ago that we did this show, right? And Jack was, he was stunned by what I said, but I was taking it from the character of what was written, not what some, pardon the expression, Caucasian man, even though he's brilliant, and we love him, Steve Sondheim. I'm sorry, that was his unconscious bias. Just like Jerry Lewis, just like all those, you know, Mickey Rooney in Tiffany, Breakfast at Tiffany's, right. And I thought, well, you know, if you want that, then you should get another actor. And that was the first time that I really stood up for something that I believed in. And it, thank God I had just come off of a television series, so I had the money that I could say no. But it was important for me. And Jack thought about it, and he called me back, and he said, Jody, you got the job. You don't have to do the accent. And that was, for me, a small victory.
That's a huge victory. That's a huge victory.
You know, nobody knew. I mean, I didn't go on stage with a sign going, I didn't have to do the accent. But it was really, you know, and you go through these things in your career where you have to say, okay, there's a line here that I have to draw, because what's that going to put forth? Right? What stereotype is that going to put forth? And what? How can I help? So anyway, that's enough for me.
That's so tough, and that's such an important story. Thank you so much for sharing that, because the lives that you've probably changed just by that one act, by standing up for yourself, but for everybody in this room, I mean, that's a really big deal. So thank you for sharing that. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm just going to repeat that. Like, thank you for trailblazing that, and for actors like me that are starting out in the industry, it really means a lot, and it's very inspiring, and thank you for sharing your stories. Those stories resonate so much. I think when I first moved out to America 10 years ago, there weren't a lot of roles for us, and if there were, they were quite stereotypical, you know. You're either a tech whiz, or you're a criminal, or you're an idiot. And I found a lot of just, you know, a lot of idiot roles, actually. And I'm personally very self-deprecating. Like, that's kind of my humor. That's the way I kind of, it's something I'm trying to change about myself, because I don't think it's healthy. And when the industry laughs with you, at the time I thought it was, oh, they think I'm funny, they think I'm, you know, a comedic actor. But really what it was is that they were laughing at me. And I did those roles because at the beginning you have to just work. You have to just
pay your rent.
You have to pay your rent, and you want to build those credits, and you want to build rapport with casting directors and producers and directors. And I played all those roles. I played the tech whiz, the idiot, the criminal. And I think the moment that I realized that I was doing that that was it was a little heartbreaking. So moving on from that, and I think that was during COVID, when I have some time to think and meditate on the work that I've done and been able to accomplish. Since then, I've really tried to make an active effort to, you know, pass on some roles. Go for roles that are closer to who I am and who I want to be, who I want to present to the world, and people who aren't just shiny figures, but also have flaws and they're human. And I'm saying no to certain roles for the respect of myself and the culture and the generation after me as well. So that's where I'm at. I will say America is doing a lot better than Australia, and Australia have a lot of work to do. And I just want to say that publicly, because I want to work back in Australia. I'm here because there's more opportunity than Australia, and I really think it's important that they get with the program. They get on the same page. But I'm excited to see where the future holds. I think we're in good hands.
Mm. Yeah, please.
Speaking of like unconscious bias and what you talked about with your roles too, for the journalists that are in this room, early on in my career, probably up until the past few years, I was known as the person who was always very smiling and very happy and would go cover all the entertainment news or the world's smelliest flower that smells like rotten socks and meat. Yay! There's even a poster that is in the hallways of KGO that says, Dion Lim finds the good. And my entire past few years has been finding the bad. So I think what's interesting is that we have this model minority myth of being the, I guess, obedient race, the people who just sit and do their jobs, they do what they're told. And for me to now have to be face to face with a district attorney, shoving a microphone in an attorney's face running down the street, or holding someone accountable to the point where they reverse course, they reverse action, it gets people to listen. I mean, now I can roll up to the courthouse without wearing high heels, trying to be the tallest person, and it'll be like the parting of the waves, because it's my voice becoming stronger because people now understand that I'm a player. And I think all of you guys have realized that we have a play that we can do that is not what everybody expects us to be.
And it's so layered. It's not just, you know, within our industry, but it's also generational and what we inherit from our parents and how we're taught to be in society. And the idea of being able to turn down roles, I think it's so powerful. Or even if you just look at it in our industry, opportunities based on what you believe in and just standing up for yourself, I think that's incredibly powerful. And it really is making change. So let's talk about how you feel that the media industry as a whole can really help Asian Americans and help uplift us. Dion, you kind of mentioned that, you know, it starts not just for people on camera, but also behind the scenes, and not just in Hollywood, but also in journalism. So
yeah,
talk to us about that.
Because think about this. The people who are on TV look diverse for the most part, even though an AAJA study just came out saying that we're grossly underrepresented. But it's the people who are in those editorial meetings, the people who have the power to say, yes, I want you to go cover that story, or no, I don't think that's a good idea, that really matter right now too. So I just think that we need to understand that we have to be something that we are not typically thought of sometimes, and that is going into these management roles or speaking out when we need to or finding that allyship that's so necessary. I could go on and on about this, though.
That's interesting. I don't know what to say about that, but this is what keeps popping in my mind is humanity, humanize people. I feel like words are powerful, and horrible words have been used about us, and dehumanizing. It's like, you know, the rules of war. Dehumanize the enemy by calling them names, and you know, you call them krauts and chinks and gooks, and it dehumanizes that.
Kung flu.
And kung flu. And when I see the news and videos of Asians being beaten up, there's anger, right? Anger among us, and go, why, how can people do that? But at the same time, this is so interesting. I was watching a YouTube video of Muhammad Ali, love him, and Sonny Liston. And he was the aggressor, Muhammad Ali, calling Liston big, ugly bear and dehumanizing him. And when the fight was started, I wanted him to punch this guy and knock him down. That's when I realized people who watch these news videos of Asians being beaten up, there are people there who go, oh my God, that's horrible. But there are people there who would go, I want to do that too. Because of the anger, the hatred. People are in pain right now and they want to lash out. And who's out there? Who's the punching bag? The subservient Asians. They're not going to complain. And that is, I think, reporting something. I know you need to be objective, but I think you need to push that a little bit to the more humanized people and give more, frame it better than just, this is what happened. Here's the video. I don't know. I don't know the answer, but it's so interesting that the other side of that, how do you convince that? Because our side would just go, anger. But the other side has anger. How do you solve that? Anger, it's not going to solve anything. So I'm not saying anything. I'm just saying how I feel. I don't have any answers, but, thoughts.
As you're talking and as you have this fury that I think all of us feel, one solution potentially, and I've always thought about looking ahead too, because there's only so much you can do. I mean, to raise awareness, that's one thing, but where do we go from here? I always think about normalization, because we have been fetishized, right? We have been seen as the other or foreign. And isn't that where people start to lash out? Because they're afraid, they don't know, they're uneducated. Can we incorporate, whether it be Hollywood or journalism, even if it's a story that is not in pertinence to Asian Americans, can we incorporate them somehow so that they become normal? It's not an Asian American story, but let's go out on the street and get that man on the street interview and consciously seek someone out so that way John John is an everyday American.
Yeah, I think someone's phone is going. I think the other is all, that's the key word. You know, when Lost came out, right? Daniel Day Kim, all those people on that show, right? They were speaking Korean. Not that they couldn't, although I think a few of them had to learn it. But, you know, I was like, why are they doing that? All the Caucasian people aren't speaking with an accent or a foreign language.
I thought that too. I thought that too.
Right? And at the same time, that other show was out, and the two Japanese guys were speaking Japanese. I was like, what is happening here? Because it's always making us the other. And it was the same thing on that Oscars, that we all raised our hand and said, you got to stop this, guys, you know? And I just think that the stories are important that we tell, whether it's in a film or a script or even on television, that we have to, we're Asian Americans, whether we have an accent or not. We are part of the fabric of this country. And that's the thing that I feel we have to, you don't have to like bang them over the head with it, but that's the thing that we have to say, hey, we're just like you in our struggles and in our aspirations and hopes here in America, you know? And that's why, anyway, but I think the other is normalizing it and...
I get you.
Okay, I don't know where to start here, but I had an encounter in San Diego, and it was a big guy at a bar who was trying to intimidate me, and I always wondered why, like, he would do such a thing and call me such a name. And I went away, I left, and then I went back to that city, and there was a bit of trauma there. Even though he didn't physically hurt me, he just said hurtful things. And there was a fear there, and I didn't want to go outside in that city again. I kind of wanted to stay at my friend's place, but my friend, you know, convinced me that it was just a one-off thing and it's not going to happen again. A similar thing happened immediately as soon as we went out, and I was like, oh, okay, I'm never going back to the city again. And I realized that was the problem for me, is that they won in that moment because they didn't want me to be seen at that bar or at that place. And I realize that it's because they don't want us to be visible. They don't want us seen out in public. And that's when I thought, excuse my language, but fuck that. I'm going to be seen, I'm going to go back, and I'm not going to be scared, even though it was hard. But the same thing goes for television and film. We have to be seen, and we have to start not only just doing the roles, but we also need to be talking to the producers and the writers and telling them our story, making sure we're being heard and being seen, because representation is the most important thing, especially right now in this really trying time where they are trying to get rid of us. They are trying to make us scared, and they're trying to keep us inside, basically. And I think this is the most important time. I think going back to talking to the producers and the writers, they need to hear it from us, otherwise it's not going to be written. And on top of that, for Asian actors, writers, just keep creating, keep making stuff, keep making us more human, and hopefully, I'm really hoping that will, you know, really change the way we see our culture and the many facets of our beings. And yeah, that's kind of all. Yes.
And creating them ourselves.
Yes.
Telling your story and your story and our stories and your story. That is really, really important, because until our stories become part of the, what is it, the diasma, whatever it's called, right, then that's when we start to really become part of this society. I really believe that. And, you know, the farewell with Awkwafina, with Nora, you know, that was such a beautiful story because people could relate to it, not just because it was Chinese, because it was a family story, and everyone has a family, you know. And so that's, for me, that's important. But you're young, so you can do that, you know. And I've just done it myself, and, you know, and you telling the stories is important.
Yeah. I mean, and who better, I don't even think that other people can capture the nuance like we can about not only our own lives, but our own cultures. I can't understand, you know, where you come from. We are all so different, even though we might look, you know, similar, we all have incredibly different backgrounds. So you're right, it's incredibly important to do that. I hope you all walk away today feeling inspired and uplifted, even though this was a difficult conversation. My name is Veronica Miracle, and on behalf of SAG-AFTRA, Dion Lim, John Briones, Jody Long, and Jordan Rodriguez, thank you all so much. We appreciate you, and we hope you have a great day.